Good evening. This lecture will be לרפואת אליהו אוראל נוח בן יהודי and לזיווג במהרה של מרדכי אהרון יוסף בן מרים שרה. I also wanted to dedicate this lecture to those web of the derech that should have the merit to do tshuva and all the sick people and the unemployed people with the difficult situation. Also, לעילוי נשמת אברהם בן אדיזוי אל שמחה בן ישועו אל רפואת אליזה מלכה בת לאה. טוב, ברוך השם, we got the good news of Jonathan Pollard. Finally, all the restriction on him was removed on last Shabbat. Shabbat he mekor habracha. And finally, we'll let him go to Israel. And the interesting thing is that I just found out that in 2011, Hussein Obama agreed to remove the restriction from Jonathan Pollard. But there was one very nice person who convinced him not to do so. Who was it? Joe Biden. Joe Biden. Here you go. Now I'm beginning to understand what we're getting here. He was the one, meaning he's worse than Hussein Obama. So now we already know two things about the future president. One, that he's very pro-Iran. He does everything he can to help Iran. He is the one that convinced Obama to give Iran all the money, $150 billion, and to do the Iran deal. And he's about to do it again now. And the second thing is, it's not such a great supporter of Israel like other presidents were before. We are probably getting something similar to Jimmy Carter. Remember Jimmy Carter? That's what we're getting. Baruch Hashem, we have to always remember, after all the frustration and disappointments that we keep getting every day, and every hour, I should say, that is all Hashem doing it to us. Remember this. And Hashem is doing it to us because we deserve it. The truth is that we deserve a lot worse. But Hashem, with His mercy, punishing us with a limited way. If we really get what we deserve, probably we would not be able to sit here and listen to even 1 minute of Torah. Because the situation spiritually by us is not getting any better. I just noticed something very scary. I've been speaking about it for years, but even I did not know how horrible is the damage that they do. What am I talking about? The Orthodox religious magazines. The damage that they did to tens of thousands of guys and girls is beyond a spiritual holocaust. Beyond. I started to realize that almost every Bet Yaakov girl is starting to talk recently more and more in a secular fashion. I want to go to Dubai, I want to go to the Bahamas, I deserve to go on vacation. This is the girls who just graduated Bet Yaakov, the ultra-Orthodox yeshiva, speaking like Goyot from Miami. The mentality who penetrated our community is becoming more and more goyish. Worse, every month becomes worse. I was thinking to myself, where do these girls get this influence about going to an Arab country, be surrounded by Arabs over there, and going to see fancy schmancy buildings and lakes, whatever they have over there. How is it possible that girls who learn Torah non-stop for so many years, that's their dream? To go to places like this. And just when I found out where they get all these ideas, from all these magazines, every page, Dubai, kosher vacation, Florida, Bahamas, they destroyed our nation, this religious newspaper. Before you worry about Biden and Hussein Obama and Arafat, they are the killer. They made a spiritual holocaust to the Jewish nation. All these ultra-Orthodox magazines, one is a bigger murderer than the other. Not to talk about secular. For secular, we don't have any expectation. We know what's there. Every religious person will do everything he can not to bring it into his home. You know? Even if you have a kid that is off the derech, and he wants to bring those newspapers into the house, a normal parent will do everything they can to convince him to deal with his nonsense out of the house, or in a basement, or don't bring it here next to your brothers and sisters. Because we understand that those secular newspapers is a poison shot directly into the heart. But the problem is that many religious people are very naive. They don't know that these religious newspapers, they are the ones who actually killed all our children. They are the ones. And you pay money for it, to bring it into your house for Shabbat. That's what they do. Every page, fancy, schmancy, all this materialism. They ruin our generation. Not to talk about all this kfirah that they have in the articles, that they bring all kinds of fake clowns to speak about the horrible divrei Torah, with their nonsense and kfirah and all kinds of shtuyot that they spread over there. All this, I don't know where they get all these clowns to speak there. But they are the number one killer in the Jewish Orthodox community. In a normal time, in the time of Chazal, these people would not be able to walk on the street for the damage that they did to tens of thousands of teenagers. It's interesting because already 30 years ago, people like Rav Shach and Rav Menzion Abba Shaul, they already warned about the dangers of all these things. Back then, in the time of Rav Shach, the newspapers were extremely orthodox and supervised, like Hamodiyah was supervised by Rav Shach. There used to be big dole Torah that either, you know, if there's something goes wrong, they're never going to give you Ashlecha. But what happened when the gdole Torah passed away? They lose their Ashdacha. I don't know who is the Mashgichim over there. I remember 20 years ago, I went to one of the restaurants in Brooklyn. My friend was a Mashgiach there, one of the famous restaurants there. And I sat with the Mashgiach at 12 o'clock at night. And he started to tell me about the horrible things that happens at nights there in a restaurant. Modesty issues. And he said, then he begged the Ashgacha of the restaurant to convince them that they should not allow the restaurant to stay open late, because that's where all the tragedies begin to happen, 11, 12, 1 at night. When they open, it's become like the bars of Manhattan. And he told me, if you see what I see here every day and I eat my heart from what I see here, it was the Yerush HaMayim, perhaps. I don't think it's in America, but back then. And he was telling me things from the community of Brooklyn, or things that are happening there. I tell you the truth, I could never believe what he was telling me. It's just not possible to believe such thing. Today, unfortunately, after 20 years, I see that he was right about everything he said. Back then, I thought to myself, maybe this guy liked to exaggerate, to make it look a lot worse than what it is. But unfortunately, now I see that everything was telling me actually happened back then. See the results of it today. So, if you really want your children to be religious, lovers of Hashem, lovers of Torah, make sure they don't have access to any religious newspaper, and not to talk about internet religious news website. They are mass murderers, not just murderers. What they do over there, they murder rabbis every week over there, they take someone, murder him, publish articles about him, destroy these families. For years they've been doing it with their stupid articles and Lashon Hara. They don't know Aleph Bet of Lashon Hara. Where does it say in the Torah you're allowed to publish the truth about anyone who is Yiresh HaMayim Shomer Shabbat? Where does it say such thing? Show me who allowed such a thing. You just found out your neighbor or his cousin did something horrible. You're allowed to go and tell people on the street. You're allowed to be olech rachil, it's a surdo reita. Who gave them permission to write rechilut Every week, the newspaper is full of rechilut about people. Even when people make big party, you're not allowed to report it. The Gemara says, if you say about someone that his house is full of steaks, good food, it's also a lashon hara. Why? Because people will understand that this guy only cares about his money. Food, meaning, he's like hungry like a pig. That's what's on his mind. All these meals. You understand? Even from something that you're trying to compliment a person, some people understand it as a negative thing. So even when you compliment a person, usually how it goes, you give him 5-6 compliments, there's always a but. Besides, or but only this and that. That's enough, that's it. Just murder me. He's sold away. You give him 500 compliments, and in the end you tell them, oh, he's a thief. His life is over. Nobody wants to do business with him, nobody wants to marry his kids. One word. But you gave him a lot of compliments. Who cares about the compliments? Nobody looks at the good things, everyone looks at the one bad things you say, and that's it. You understand? So that's the problem, Rabotai. The generation became a zoo. And there's more and more influenced by the culture of the goyim and their horrible media. Is this what's going on? A lot of these tragedies come to us because of the university education that a lot of Orthodox people got in the last 30 years. The poison of the university and the heresy went to every place. No matter what kind of university, they all have their kfirah. And it goes into the people that sits there, and that's affect the hashkafa. You see right away. You understand? And we are already living in a generation. We don't have any more leaders like Rav Avigdor Miller or other big Dole Torah that were straight like a ruler. They never cared about politics or what the people would say. Where do you have leaders like this today? You know, I heard that they made a very big wedding, thousands of people in the corona time now. They just made it. It came out of the news today. The biggest chilul Hashem, biggest. Such a huge chilul Hashem. Not only that the goyim go crazy as it is from the situation, their situation, things that they see by Jewish people, with their, anyway, their anti-Semitism, right? It's already existed before. It's nothing new. And they see that they cannot make weddings, and they cannot go to restaurants, and they cannot gather in the office more than few people, and they have all these restrictions, which are extremely annoying to Jews and to non-Jews. So this goyim trying to follow the rules, not to be in places together, not to be in restaurants. Every restaurant makes you free seats outside. All these restrictions, and all of a sudden, they turn on their television, and they see 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 Hasidim dancing, like nothing is happening. And I'm thinking, now who knows how many people got corona there. They're not worried that some of them will die. Believe me, that's the last thing they worry about. They worry about how many of us will die because of them. When they walk around into our business, into our stores, into our neighborhoods, and some of them will have it, we're gonna die. And then people will wonder why we're going to get another Holocaust because of this eventually, when they're going to start with the riots again. Then they'll wonder, why it happened to us? How many times I've said, when you have a lion in a cage with you, you don't want to attract his attention. Don't move, don't make noise, don't make sharp moves, don't get him angry. Don't do anything that he will pay attention to you. Be on the corner and be as quiet as possible. It's time of judgment in the world. It's time of anger. There's craziness everywhere. You didn't see what happened in the riots. Where were you? You didn't see what they did? You don't see how cruel they are? Do you know what will happen if you fall in their hands? What's going to happen in the communities here in Queens, Brooklyn, in other places? Do you know what will happen? It can be a bloodshed. Who do you think is going to protect you? Police themselves, they don't care anymore what's happening. It's total anarchy here. Total. They are abused. The mayor destroyed them, cut their budget. Nobody gives them respect. They are hated by all the liberal Democrats of New York State. And you expect them to come defend the Jews? People just live in illusion. Why bring the problem and hope that things will be good? That's smart. People have to keep low profile, low profile. You're a visitor here. What do you mean? I'm 5 generations here. I'm 200 years here. You're still a visitor here. The Torah say the Jews will always be isolated. Always. Am levadad ishkon. Uvagoyim lo itchashav. There's two ways to explain it. That the Jews will be isolated from the Goyim, or the other way around, that the Goyim would look at them down, meaning, you know, the worst possible way. One way or the other, like I said, when you have someone that you know is not crazy about you, let's not say hate you, but not crazy about you, not exactly his friend, you have to do everything you can not to ignite him. Once you ignite him, he will ignite his brother, which will ignite his cousin, which will ignite the neighbor. And before you realize, in a month, you're going to have thousands of crazy people out there, and who knows what's going to be next. That's what people don't understand. Nobody wants to learn from history. Read the Tanakh, see how many times we've been in this movie already. Another pogrom, and another pogrom, and another attack, and another Kristallnacht, and another Holocaust, and another destruction, and another exile. Hundreds of times. Don't you get the point? What is this? Oh, we're powerful, we are educated, we are rich. Don't understand what's going on here. You know, this parasha is a perfect example of some of the things that are happening. We're going to speak about some of the things. You know, every line in the Torah is a school for life. School for life. There are parts of the Torah that are more educational to us than other parts. Like when we read about the laws of sacrifices in the time of the temple, it doesn't teach us that much about today's generation. But when we read about the story of Yaakov and Esav, how Yitzchak behaved to them, how Rivka, what happened, how it reflects today, 3,400 years later in the world, how the Holocaust came to the world from Yaakov and Esav, how the beginning of the Holocaust was actually in this parasha, parasha Toldot, you begin to see the pattern on the world, how Hashem runs the world and all the cycles that keeps repeating. We're going to see some of the things that will, Be'ezrat Hashem, educate us in such a way that we'll be able to at least try to do the right thing. We have a story of Yitzchak Avinu. He sees that his wife, she's barren. Ve'yetar Yitzchak le'Hashem le'nochach ishto. Now we need to Hashem because of the situation of his wife. So, the Gemara in Masechet Nedarim, page 40, the Gemara says, Ma'aseh betalmid echad. Something happened with a student. He was a student of Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva had a student, he was one of them. He became sick. Nobody came to visit him. He's sitting at home, laying in bed. Nobody comes to visit him. And Rabbi Akiva, the great Rabbi Akiva, the big rabbi, he came to visit him. He came, he gave him respect, he cleaned the place, the room where he was alone, gave him what he needs, maybe probably need water to replace things. The student told him, Rabbi Yechiatami, you revived me. I was already dead, meaning mentally, not just physically. You brought me back to life. Rabbi Akiva came out and said, everyone who does not visit the sick, he is like a murderer, not less. Ke'ilu shofech damim. It counts like you actually killed him. When it's corona, pandemic, it's contagious, okay, your life comes before his life. Nobody asks you to die for someone else, right? Okay, fine. But if it's nothing contagious, it's laying in bed, it's dying, whatever the case is, maybe had an accident, and you can actually do, today Baruch Hashem, we have these video calls, that's also Bikur Cholim. You speak to him on a video, because remember, it's mentally, it brings him up. Oh, I'm far away, you're in Florida, I'm in New York, but we're thinking about you, be well, we're davening for you. Oh, that's very good. It's like the conversation face to face, Baruch Hashem. Back in time, you didn't have these options. You had to come physically. So, Rabbi Shimon Sofer, he says like this, the Gemara, he is adding on the words of the Gemara, he says there's a secret here. What's the secret? It's not enough when you pray for the sick in the synagogue. If you are in a synagogue and you pray for the sick person, it's not as good as when you actually go to his room in a hospital and pray, or in his house. What's the difference? Your mouth is different. Hashem can hear you here, and he can hear you there. What difference does it make if I'm here praying for you, or if I come all the way to where you are and I pray for you? The answer is, Rabotai, listen carefully. Because when he's not here, you want to do Mishabarach for him, you want to read Tehillim for him, you have to say his name and his parents' name. Ploni ben Ploni, Reuven ben Shimon. What happens if his parents are wicked? They're not Shomer Shabbat, they're liberal, lefty, anti-Torah, apikorsin, like so many other people out there. But the boy is righteous, but his parents are wicked. So you have to say, Reuven, son of a big Rasha. Just when you mention the name of the Rasha, all the value of the prayer went down 99%. Because in Shamayim they hate Rasha'im. Not like here, politically correct fakers run to kiss up to them. In Olam HaEmet, nobody can stand them. Even their own family cannot stand them. It's a very big embarrassment. If you come to Shamayim and you Rasha, Mechalel Shabbat, do all the horrible things that the Torah hates, even your own grandparents are very embarrassed that you came out of them. Very embarrassed. So, in Olam HaEmet, as soon as you mention the name of Rasha, right away they said, this is who you want to have cure, the son of this Rasha. So when you come to pray by him, you don't have to mention his parents. How do we learn it? From Moshe Rabbeinu. When Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for Miriam, he did not have to say a name and not her parents' name. What did he say? El na refan ala. Please cure her. What does it mean, her? Her, she's here. She's right here. Cure her. You don't have to say names.
Wasn't Moshe Rabbeinu's father to go to
God? No, Moshe had no problem to mention his parents. We learn from Moshe that when you're together in the same place with someone that you're praying for, you don't have to mention his parents. You say, please cure him, please cure her, meaning they're right in front of us. But when you're not in front of them, you have to mention their parents, because there's thousands of Reuven. Which Reuven you're praying for, right? So you say, Reuven ben such and such. But if the parents are tzaddikim, it's good to mention them. If you're davening for the son of the Baba Sali, fantastic to mention his name, or Rav Ovadia, or Ben Ish Chai, or any one of those. So it's very good to bring them up. But if you know the parents of this person are Mechalili Shabbat, better not to mention their name. That's why there's a big advantage on going to where the sick person is and pray for him while he's there. This we learn it from Moshe Rabbeinu. As it's written here, the father of Rivka was who? Big Rasha. Who is Rivka from? Where Rivka came from? Betzuel Rasha. And she has also a brother that is Rasha, that has Rachel and Rivka, and Leah from there. So both of them Rasha'im. When you want to pray for Leah and Rachel, you don't want to mention their father Lavan. When you pray for Rivka, even when you pray for Abraham, you don't want to mention Terach. However, Terach, unlike them, he did tshuva before he died. So if you say Abraham ben Terach, it's not such a big deal. He made tshuva, after all. Okay.
Why doesn't take account that he's a big tzaddik?
Who?
Let's say for tshuva for big tzaddik, or the father's
word. Tzaddik, tzaddik. But once you mention the name of a Rasha, it's already ruined the atmosphere. Right? The way the Satan is using it. Hey, my... Look who is giving credit to this Rasha, is mentioning this Rasha, right away it ruins the atmosphere. So it says like this, Lenochach Ishto, why Yitzchak had to be be next to Rivka every time he prayed for it. What does it mean, lenochach ishto? When ishto is in front of him, when his wife is in front of him, then he doesn't have to mention the name of her father. Because we learned something here. Baruch Hashem. Vayater lo Hashem. Hashem took his request. Rashi writes, nitpatzar venitpayes venitpatalo. Meaning, what does it mean, all these words? Rav Chaim Zonnenfeld, Zatzal, he said later in the parasha, Pasuk Lamed, we will learn, Vayazed Yaakov Nazid. Yaakov made lentil soup, right? Red lentil soup. And Esav came and said, Aliteni min ha'adom hazeh, spill this red soup into my throat, directly. Rashi said that that day Avraham Avinu passed away. It was the, you know, Avraham just passed, it was 175. He should have lived to 180, but Hashem shortened his life by 5 years. He won't see Esav is going off the derech. Up to now, Esav was, from the outside, look tzaddik. He's pretending. But now that's it. He cannot hide anymore who he is. So Hashem did not want Avraham to be upset. He took 5 years of his life. Something here is a little bit difficult to understand. We're talking 5 years of life. If you ask now people what they would prefer, to die 5 years younger without knowing that the grandson is going off the derech, became some drug addict or something, or that they would rather live and live with the pain, right? After all, we're talking about grandson, not son. Son is much harder. Son, the Gemara says, if someone has a son that goes off the derech, a child, it's worse than Milchemet Gog u'Magog. The war of Gog u'Magog is the final war which basically destroyed the whole world. As Zachary 14 described, that two-thirds of the people in the world would die. It would be a nightmare. What's going to happen in the whole world? So you compare this to one kid went off the derech? He's not religious anymore, he took off his kippah and tzitzit and his mechalel Shabbat. You compare this to almost the whole world is going on fire? The answer is, if you ask strangers, what's worse, that a Jewish kid who used to be a Bachur Yeshiva became some gangster on the street, or 5 million people died and all the world is on fire? Everyone would say, with all the pain to this Bachur Yeshiva, obviously, the tragedy of the entire world is much worse, right? It's millions of people dead. So we're not talking for us. Yes, for us, Gog u'Magog is the worst thing that you can imagine. We're talking for the father of that boy. For the father of that boy, the pain of his son is worse than to see the entire world goes on fire. Mentally, it destroys him mentally, it breaks his heart. Is much more broken than any other tragedy. Why? Because remember the rule. When someone died, it's horrible pain. Someone who buried this child, it's horrible pain. But someone that his child went off the derech, it's much, much worse pain. Why? Because it's written, Gadol ha-machti'o yoter min ha-orgo. If you take a Jew and you murder him physically, horrible crime, death penalty. Horrible crime. However, if you make him go off the derech, he was Shomer Shabbat, he was Bachur Yeshiva, and you took him out and made him like a goy. That's it, no more religion, no more nothing. That's a much bigger crime than actually murder him physically, right? So what do you see from here? Because when you murder the body, you took 30, 40 years of his life. When you actually murder his soul, you took his share to the eternal world. He lost his share in the eternal world. So you actually murdered him for eternity, not for 30, 40 years. When you kill someone, you move him from here to here. Sometimes you upgrade him. Still not allowed to murder him, but since you already chose to do it, for him it was an upgrade. He went express to heaven, especially if he died on Kiddush Hashem, if it's some Greeks or Romans or Arabs who killed him because he's a Jew and he did not want to bow down to the idol or anything like that, then it's a real upgrade. He's still not allowed to murder, obviously. But if you take him to become a non-observant Jew, That's it, he lost his eternity. So the crime, the consequences of the crime is a billion times worse. I want to tell you, speaking about burying a son, that's one of the things that saves a person from a lot of punishments in the next world. Someone that buries his own children, lo alein. Baruch Hashem, the way of the world is that children bury their parents. That's the normal way. And here and there we find out about children who bury their own, the parents that bury their own children. It happens, unfortunately. In accidents, and now with all kinds of things. So, he used to be a rabbi here in Mir Yeshiva in Brooklyn. And his name was Rav Shmuel Birenbaum. And he had a son, Rabbi Ariel Birenbaum. So, Birenbaum. So, his son died in his lifetime. And he made a eulogy for his own son. Everyone was crying, such a tragedy to a big rabbi like this. So in his eulogy, he said something that we should never ever forget. Listen to this. It says that when Avraham Avinu took Yitzchak to the Moriah mountain to do the Akedah, to slaughter him, once he tied him, he told him, tie me tight that I won't move, that the slaughtering will be kosher. It's like a sacrifice. And it's written that the angels, Hashem opened the heavens, that the angels came all the way down to this world in a physical manner, and they saw that and they were crying. It was very touchy to see our father slaughter his only son after he waited for him for 75 years. And they were crying and their tears fell into his eyes, which later will make him blind. That's the reason for Yitzchak's blindness. Why do you need such a reason to explain how Yitzchak became blind? Why can't you just say old people become blind sometimes? You become 90, 100, 110, 120, 150, you may become blind. There's no such thing. If a person all of a sudden one day needs glasses, it's because he looked at something he was not supposed to look at. We were learning from a story with a stipler, the holy stipler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky. A stipler, one time he spoke in the yeshiva that if you watch your eyes, you will never have vision problems. One of the students asked him, Kvod Harav, how someone like you watch his eyes absolutely, complete God to your eyes, how all of a sudden you have glasses? In age 90-something. So he told him, I was walking the other day on the streets of Bnei Brak, and I passed by some kiosk, you know, that they sell newspapers, and they put the newspapers in the front on the stand, and I turned my face, and accidentally, I stared for 1 second on the front cover of the lefty, liberal, wicked newspaper. In Israel, idiot, mass murderer newspaper. 60-70 years, they're murdering souls. And I looked at their front page, right away I turned my face. But I already knew that second the price I'm going to pay. The next day I could not read. The next day, I came to learn the next day, it was in the evening yesterday, in the morning I can't read. I needed to go to make glasses. Some people, it would happen to them, they would say, well, I got old. Well, we all get old, so we need glasses. No, no, not everybody needs glasses. There were people 100 years old, they need glasses. I've seen some videos of Gdolei Israel in their 90s and even past 100, reading, small writing, without reading glasses. I've seen Rav Steinemann in one of the videos sitting learning Gemara in his home when he's 100 years old. No reading glasses. Today people get reading glasses age 40 already. Rav Chaim Kanievsky doesn't have reading glasses. Understand? So what do you see? What you're looking at, you look at not modest things on the street, you hurt your vision. You hear things you're not supposed to hear. you hurt your ears, if not in this world, in the next reincarnation. If not in the next Gilgul, in the next world. But it's going to be consequences to it. So Shmuel Birnbaum, he asked a question, he said, why did Hashem need to bring the angels all the way down to this world to see the Akedah? They could have seen it from there. Huh? Why do you need to open the heavens? The answer is, what you see from there and what you see from here is completely different. Like two opposites. Let me explain. Rashi say when Hashem gave the Torah, He opened the seven heavens above us. Shiva Rekim. And everybody saw there is one Hashem, everybody understood in that event that there's one God and giving out the Torah. Rabbi Birnbaum said a story about the Ramban. From here you will understand a lot about life. The Ramban lived 750 years ago and he was a big legendary Kabbalist. The Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, lives in Barcelona. Then he went to Israel. After he had a debate with some Christian priest and crushed him to pieces, they went crazy, the Christians in Spain over there. Remember, back then everybody was extremely Christian. It wasn't like today, most of them not religious. It was such a sword to their heart, to their ego, with their fake, foolish religion, that the rabbi made such fun of all of us with our foolish religions. They warned him, if you don't leave tonight, by tomorrow you'll be dead already. They're not going to let you leave. And he had to run away, and he came to Yerushalayim, and he had the shul of the Ramban there, Bet Knesset HaRamban, The Ramban had a student that was dying. He came to the student, and he said to him, look, you are going to a world that is all good. You're going to the upper world, don't panic. He was a righteous kid, righteous student. I have one request for you. I have some questions about the way Hashem runs the world that I don't understand. I would like you, when you come to Hashem, please, I'm going to write to you, I'm going to tell you all the questions. I'm going to write to you now all the special names of the angels for protection. With these names, it's like a passport. You're gonna go through all the heavens and reach all the way to the top heaven, which is the seventh one. That's where Kisei HaKavod is. All the way to the chair of Hashem. And once you go over there, please ask Hashem all my questions directly and come to me in a dream and tell me all the answers. I'm sending you on a mission. There are names, it's called an amulet. Today you have to be very careful who you're getting an amulet from. Some people fake Kabbalists that can make you more damage than help you. Especially if they're not holy and they're fakers and Shemirachem, they have Tumah. You have to be very careful. I have this from Rav Kaduri. Rav Kaduri was the chief of the Kabbalists. He wrote this amulet with the names of all these angels. That's very good for Shmirah, for many things. But if you go to someone you don't know who he is, it's a big chance. You take a big chance. It may help you, it may destroy you, Chas v'Shalom. Because you have to be careful, because you're dealing with a very delicate, very high spiritual level of secrets here. So the Ramban wrote to him all these names. He gave him a note and he said, we're going to bury you with this note. Close your hands. And he died like this. Once a person dies with his hand closed, can't open it, that's it. Can't open the fingers. The student died. After exactly 7 days, the Shiva finished. He came to the Ramban in a dream, to his rabbi. He said to him, Rabbi, I want you to know that I read, just like you said, I went with your notes and the names that you wrote, every place they opened the doors for me. I went higher and higher and higher and higher until I reached the top. And that's over there. When I reach over there, I had all of a sudden no questions. All the questions were so obvious already that it was not a question anymore. There was nothing to ask. So the Ramban told him, that's exactly what I expected you to answer. When we are living here in this material world and Hashem is testing us, we have so many dilemmas, so many question marks. This is the purpose of this world, to test the person. You have faith or you don't have faith? You trust me or you don't? You have questions against what I bring to you, good or bad? You think the bad is bad, you think the good is good, you don't know anything from your life. The bad could have been good, the good could have been bad. You don't even know simple things. You want to understand how I do things, in this world you can't understand. When you reach the world of the truth, you don't need to ask. Everything becomes crystal clear. So that's exactly what the Rav Shmuel Barenboim saying. The angels up there in Shamayim, when they saw Avraham take Yitzchak to the Akedah, he's tying him, he's ready to slaughter him. They said, what's the big deal? Why he deserves such credit? Everyone would do this. Who would dare to go against Hashem's request? Why you make such big deal out of this, Hashem? What's so special about Avraham? Because over there it's Olam HaEmet, there's no Yetzer Hara, no infatuations, nothing. Hashem say yes, yes, from here it's all very clear, no question. I'm opening all the heavens, go all the way down. Go to the world of human being. Be in their shoes. And then you come back to me and tell me if it was a great thing or not. When they came to this world and they see now Avraham after 75 years he waited, and Avraham was teaching the Goyim not to slaughter their own children and not to burn them for their idols. And Hashem doesn't love that you kill your own babies. And Hashem already promised him, you're going to have a son that will inherit you. After all of this, Hashem sent to him, take Yitzchak, and he ride away early in the morning. He takes his donkey, he's preparing it, running to do it. And the angel told him, no, don't do it. You now we know you really a fearing God, you're a God-fearing individual. We know that you're righteous. No, let me do it. I came on the way. The angels, they couldn't believe it. It was very touchy. They all started to cry. What an event! 75 years he waited for that son, and look how he's waiting for him to give his life. So that's when they started to cry. Oh, eventually, those tears, later on, the tears that went into the eyes of Yitzchak, later made him blind. Now he's blind. When you're blind, your Yetzer Hara goes away, most of it. Most of the things that we like is because the eyes see, and then the heart desire, right? If a person look at a lot of flashy things, flashy, and makes him jealous. I want this, I want the car like this, I want shidduch like this, you see a girl like this, oh, I wish I would have like a shidduch like her. All of this starts in the eyes. However, when a person lives in the darkness, he can't see anything. He doesn't, even when he eats food, he doesn't enjoy the taste. When you don't see what you eat, you don't enjoy. Next time when you eat something, close your eyes for the entire meal and see how it reduced most of the pleasure. You know, I'll tell you a story. In the end of the Second World War, the Nazis, Yimach Shimah, they already almost finished to murder all the Jews of Europe. And in the meantime, the Allies, United States, Russia, England, all these countries, were winning against the Nazis. Slowly, They actually beating them and pushing them back into Germany. So the Nazis in Bergen-Belsen, there was a camp that still had a lot of Jews there, but it had a section of Russian soldiers that they captured in a war. So there's Russian Goyim soldiers, and you have all the Jews over there in Bergen-Belsen. So the Nazis came to them, they were not losing. Any day they're gonna lose, they're gonna have to run. So they say to them, we would like you to make good impression on the Russians and the Americans when they reach the camp. We want you to tell them how fair we were with you. So that's why we brought to you hot bread rolls, like challah rolls, hot from the bakery, in baskets. 5 years. 5 years they were starving over there. They looked like skeletons. There was not one normal meal there, ever. Like skeletons. 5 years. So they made them wait online. And one of the Jews over there, this Jew, is thinking, wow, there is only 7 rolls left. Will I get one or not? He counts in front of him 6 people. Yes, I will be the last one to get the last roll. Wow, ishtabach shemo, thank God. Everybody took a roll and he was the last one, they gave him a roll. And that's it, the basket was empty. Then he saw another line, and over there they also give rolls. Over here we all shaved, they don't recognize who we are. Why don't I go and take advantage, finally get another roll? Why only one? Finally they brought finally normal bread here. Let me stand again online. He stood one more time, they gave him another roll. Now he has 2 warm rolls. What a dream. You know, over there when you don't eat for 5 years, it clogged your judgment and your thinking completely. One of the survivors saying, if someone would come and tell you, what would you prefer, a good meal now, or to suffer 1 more week and next week to get out of the camp to freedom? You're free. You would say, give me 1 meal now. Because the torture was so bad that you could not imagine now another week going like this. Give me 1 meal now and keep me here forever. That's how bad it was. So now he has 2 rolls. Soon as he walks with the 2 rolls, trying to find a place to eat it, who came? The Russian, the Cossacks, grabbed him by the neck. Hey, you Jew, come here. Boom, boom, punches to the face, kicking his stomach, kicking his ribs, his legs. Few Russians beating him up, stole the 2 rolls from his hand. And he fainted. Before he fainted, he was looking up to the sky and said, I don't understand, Hashem, what else do you want from me? 5 years I'm tortured here. Finally, they brought bread here. Everyone got, and I finally had it in my hand, and now you don't let me eat it? What else do you want? Good question or no? And he fainted. After a few hours, like the morning, he woke up, all broken. He slowly gets up, he walks out of the room over there. He looks around, quiet. No cars, no Nazis, no nothing. What does he see? Everyone is dead. All the people of the camp were laying down dead. Apparently what they did, to kill them fast, they put poison inside those bread rolls. They were all full of poison. Everybody died besides him. He's the only one that survived to tell that story. So why am I telling you this story now? When he was beaten up and they took away these 2 rolls after he felt how warm they are, I don't know, it's like a treasure. What a mental crisis he would create to a person. Like you bring him all the way to the well and you don't let him drink. but did he ever took to consideration that maybe what's happening right now will save him and he's going to be able to get out of there and come to Israel and establish a new family and great children and grandchildren, thanks to the moment that the Russians kicked him and beat him up? And that was actually the greatest moment of his life. That's what sent him to freedom, those punches. Similar to what happened to the Stipler. In Russia, they took everyone to the army, even religious Jews. You have no say. They took the Stipler to the army. Shabbat came, he said to the general, I'm sorry, tomorrow I can't practice, I can't touch the gun, I can't do anything. He said to him, over here I'm the God, not you. Not your God. Over here you listen to what I say. This is communist. They make fun at religion anyway. The Stipler said, I'm sorry. With all due respect to you, I have my God already. And he commanded me not to do anything on Shabbat, so I will not do anything on Shabbat. He said to him, I suggest you don't try me, because if you're not going to do what I tell you to do, you will regret the moment you were born. Stipler said, you do whatever you want to me, there is no chance I'm going to break Shabbat. He saw he's so devoted, so he said to him, you know what, you Jew, let me make a deal with you. You want to be able to have a day off when everybody else walk here? I'm willing to give you this day off in one condition, that you're going to put your head down and every one of my soldiers with their rifles will come and hit you at the head. After all of them will do that, if you still stay alive, then we will allow you to keep Shabbat. You agree? He said, yes, I agree. So they all pass by, boom, I mean, I don't have to tell you how cruel they are, especially when they see a Jew like this. Boom, boom, his head is all cut, full of blood. Later, many years later, the Stipler said that the happiest moment of his life was that moment. That he felt finally that he reached some level in Avodat Hashem. Not when he sits in the air conditioner and enjoy a beautiful Gemara, or eat shul at Shabbos. Or you come to shul and you hear a wonderful Ashkenazi cantor singing opera, and you enjoy, and everybody enjoy the Alel and reading the Torah. Why, it's hard to be religious? People make it a lot harder than what it really is. Kosher food is a punishment? No, it's delicious, just as good. Getting dressed, you get dressed nicely. What's the problem? Get married, have children, enjoy, make business, make money, live in a comfortable home. What's the suffering of being religious? Nothing. It's all in the head. Because people like to be free. Even if you tell people, I lack you in a fancy hotel, they'll still be upset. Why? For the lockdown. Not because they suffer in a hotel. But mentally, you locked me in, I'm not free. Why? I'm giving you a 10-star hotel. Serve your meals, you lock in a room. No. Lockdown, everybody cries. Look, some people, they lock down in beautiful mansions in Long Island or in Beverly Hills. A lot of people would be very happy to be locked down in such a place. But they suffer. They don't enjoy the luxury over there. Because in their mind, I'm a prisoner here. That's what it is, Rabotai. So, the worst moments in life sometimes is actually the best moments in your life. And you're just only going to understand that later on. So the Stipler saying, I felt such satisfaction that I passed that test. Hashem kept me alive and I was able now, from now on in the army, to keep to be Shomer Shabbat. The only soldier probably in the history of the Russian army that had a dismissal for Shabbat. You don't have to do anything for this moment. They kept the word at least, these monsters. Imagine they were telling, I was just kidding with you. You understand? So, we move on. to understand, it's a little bit strange, you know, if you try to understand the Torah literally, you are totally ignorant. That's in the best case scenario, it could be worse. You don't ever try to understand the Torah literally. What you read, what you hear, what you think you understand, it's totally different than what you think. It's written in the Torah that Yitzchak Avinu say to Esav, go make me delicious food, matamim, as I love, and bring it to me that I should eat, that I should bless you before I die. This is the prophet, son of Abraham Avinu, Yitzchak. He was really ready to die on the altar of Akedat Yitzchak when he was 37 years old. We're not talking about somebody from the beach walking with his belly outside drinking beer. We're talking a holy person. I will show you dozens of Bachurei Yeshiva who the last thing they care about is food. They don't want to get up from the Gemara to go sit in the dining room. They eat a little bit of bread with some olive oil and finish. Just not to waste time. They don't care, there's sometimes delicious food. Rice, schnitzel, chickens, you know, they serve food. Burger sometimes, hot dogs, whatever. They don't want to waste time. They stay to learn. Why? Food is not a priority for them. They never care if the food is warm, if the food is hot, if it's cold, if it's spiced out, nothing, they don't care. They just eat to survive, that's it. There are two ways to live your life. You live to eat, or you eat to live. What the Torah wants you to eat in order for you to live. You need to charge your batteries. You need to eat, so what do you eat? Who cares? The chicken is like this, it's like that. The fish is like this, or like, who cares? I eat it, it makes me full for another 6-7 hours, I'm happy. But some people, the only reason they live is for food. What are they gonna eat for dinner? That's private chef. In the house, private chef. What are they gonna cook for us, George? What are you in the mood for? Chinese? Or Italian? Or Persian? I actually learned something good, Georgian food, delicious. That's how they live. What are you laughing? You have thousands of families here like this, around you. They have a private chef in the house. They're rich and famous. Not everyone publish it. It's not something to brag about, but I know families. I know a family that someone from Muncie used to cook for them and deliver the food daily to them, dinner. They didn't cook in their house. They cook in Muncie and deliver it to them. Every day, half an hour a night. Then they should have delicious, fresh dinner. Why? Because the wife is not going to cook. Right? So, therefore, it was worth it for them, instead of to hire a chef, to order from a chef from her house that she will cook for every night. So in the afternoon they would send a request, what tonight they're in the mood for. I'm not talking about this kind of people here. We're talking about Yitzchak Avinu. But from the story it sounds like he Esau, I love you. Wow, your steaks are so delicious. You know how to make deer steaks. You hunt the deer, you slaughter him. You give me the meat, medium rare, amazing. Make me a good steak that I should give you a blessing before I die. No? You really think that's what the Torah wants to tell about Yitzchak? If your father was a rabbi and he had a desire for food and he would care very much what you give him to eat, would you write it in his biography? You would hide it, no? You don't want the people to think, oh, what a low life, that's what he cares about, right? So why the Torah writes about Yitzchak such a thing? It's an embarrassment. It's Lashon Hara. Lashon Hara. That's what I'm explaining. If you try to understand the Torah literally, you always come to the wrong conclusion. Let's try to understand what's going on over here. No? Well, how is it possible that Yitzchak love Esav and Rivka love Yaakov? If you are a rabbi and you have a son that is sitting all day learning, and you have another son that is a hunter, who you automatically appreciate more, the hunter or the one who sits and learns? You learn, and he's learning. You admire him much more. How can you like the hunter coming with his ponytail and earring and his bow and arrow? Hi, Dad, what's up? You have a son in yeshiva all day with the gemarot until 11, 12 at night every day. So proud of him. Wow, Hashem gave me such a jewel. Then you have him. Hi, what's up, Dad? Comes with his jeans, with his holes. Hey, what's up? What's for dinner? You want to bury yourself. You have such a son. But according to the Torah, everything is the opposite here. All of a sudden, Yitzchak care about the food. All of a sudden, Yitzchak admire Esav. What's going on over here? You ask yourself what's going on. But before we explain that, we have another strange thing. Esav comes from the field, he's hungry. Yaakov is cooking lentil soup. Why lentil? The funeral, they eat eggs and lentil because they're round. Why you eat round things in a time of mourning? Because life is a circle. Gilgul. It goes like one circle. You come to the world with nothing and you live in the same way you left. You're back to square one. That's what it's hinting. It's a custom. Don't worry, if you didn't eat lentil when your father passed, you don't go to hell for that. It's just a custom. So Yaakov is cooking lentil soup. Delicious, red, beans, whatever it was, he shows up. Hey brother, what's up? What are you cooking there? Oh, that looks good. Pour it to my throat. Why didn't you bring a plate, give him a spoon? What's it? It's hot. Pour it to my throat. And all of a sudden, Yaakov, the Talmid Yeshiva, became a sharp killer businessman. Took advantage of the opportunity. Hey, not so fast, bro. You want to eat? Let's talk business first. No, what's business? Pay me $20 for the soup. No? It cost me money. Why? It cost me time. I went to the supermarket. Until I bought it, I cooked. Whatever the case is. Yaakov all of a sudden talk big business. I want you to sell me the Bechora, your firstborn. Transfer me the rights, the deed. You're the firstborn. Esav said, anyway, I'm going to die. What do I need to be a Bechor? What do you mean? What does it have to do with dying, not dying? Right now you're alive. Your father will die before you. You get double than your brother. It's Bechorah. Plus, in Olam Haba. So who cares if you die now, you die next year, you die in 20 years? What do they have to do now? Would you agree to give up your Bechorah? Then later the Torah says, Vayigdelu anaharim, they grew up. Esav is a hunter, he's an expert in a field. And Yaakov, ish tam, naive, tam, sitting in a tent and learning Torah. So, we have to connect the dots here. So, the Torah continues, and Rivka is listening to Yitzchak talking to Esav, and Esav is going to hunt, and Rivka quickly convinces Yaakov, come, put the custom, pretend that you're your brother, bring two goats, let me prepare them for your father, that he should eat. No, but he went to get him deer. I'm going to get him goat. He's going to know it's not Esav. Don't worry. He cannot tell the difference between a deer and a goat. Do you think he cares about food? He just told him, prepare me something like I like. That means he cares about the taste. But Rivka said, no, anyway, he doesn't know the difference. It doesn't matter. I mean, I prepare it, don't worry. So, then he's going to say, well, maybe he's going to find out that I'm not his son, he's going to curse me. Don't worry, the curse is on me. She's speaking from a prophecy. Yaakov has no choice, he wears his clothes, he comes to his Yitzchak, he's very careful not to lie. Is it you? Me. He doesn't say, me, Esav, your son, me, period. Esav is a plain treat, you know. So, Yitzchak suspecting, why? Esav never said, Bezrat Hashem, your God showed me the animal today I hunted quickly. He knows this, but something is not right here. Anyway, Yitzchak now giving Yaakov a great blessing, thinking he's blessing Esav. What's the blessing? וייתן לך אלוקים, הוא יישא את מוציא שבת. מטל השמיים, משמני הארץ, ורוב דגן ותירוש, עבדוך העמים, השתחרבו לך לאומים, ואחיך. It's basically giving him control on the whole world. It was meant for Esav, but who took it? Yaakov. Who is Yaakov? The Jews. The blessing of the Jewish people started right here. You will control the whole world. Everything in the world will be depend on your actions and decisions. Economy, armies, financial, stock markets, science, medicine, big companies. The Jews will control the world, whether the Goyim likes it or they hate it. That's a fact. It's written in a book that the Goyim admit that it's the book of God. So there's no argument here. There's only one condition we have to remember. When Esav came and he found out what happened, he started to scream and cry. He said, "Ani Esav bechorecha." What do you mean? You're not the bechor. You sold the bechorah. He said, "What do I care about the bechorah?" The Gemara says, "Kafar b'tchiyat amitim." He doesn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. He doesn't believe in life after death. Nothing. All of a sudden, he became such a tzaddik. I'm the bechor. Why you give the blessing to him? Why do you care? The answer is, when Adam and Eve, the snake convinced Chava to eat from this, from the tree. She didn't want. Hashem warned them. He pushed her on the tree. You see, you touch the tree and nothing happened. Eat, enjoy. You know why God doesn't want you to eat? If you eat, you will be like him, like another God. You will know everything. It's a big temptation. So she ate. She saw she's not alive, she's not dead. Right away she ran to give Adam. Why? Eat, the Gemara say, eat that if I die, you also die. Because I don't want to die and leave you here to take another girl. That's what the Gemara said, but it doesn't make sense. Because she already ate from the tree and she didn't die. And the snake convinced her, you're not going to die, Hashem took you. You're not going to die. But all of a sudden, she worried that she will die and Adam will stay alive. Meaning, I don't mind to die so much, as long as you die with me. Number one. Number two, what happened that before she didn't believe and she ate from, now all of a sudden she's worried about dying? The answer is, it applies to each one of us, that's human nature. When the desire is in front of you and you're on fire for it, your brain is frozen. You don't think it's unhealthy, it's a lot of sugar, I'm diabetic, they're gonna chop my legs off, I'm gonna become blind, anyway already I have symptoms. The more I gain weight, the more I'm gonna die faster, I'm gonna get a heart attack. You know all of it is a fact. Right now, only now, only now. Soon as you eat and satisfy your desire, you're rational again. The freeze is released. And you begin to think again logically. That's what human being is all about. אין אדם חוטא, אלא היא נכנסת בו רוח שטות, אמר עשה. Why a person will make a sin? The Torah told you the consequences of your sins. You're going to pay a very heavy price for this one-minute desire, for this one-minute pleasure. You just ate pork. 2 minutes you enjoy, and you're going to suffer 39 times in a week. Shloshim ha'tesha malkot. Who wants to get 39 times for 1 or 2 minutes pleasure? I can't help it. I have to do it. Look at my saliva, it's dripping. So, the question we have to ask, it's written that Yitzchak got very scared when Esav showed up. Rashi says he saw hell is opening for him. Hell opened up. When Yaakov came in, he smelled heaven. When Esav came in and he realized what happened now, the question is, how Rivka dared to do such a trick? Yitzchak is the boss, no? He is the prophet, and he wants to give the blessing to the to Esav the Bechor, and to give Yaakov a different blessing, maybe. But you come and switch, but you're tricking him, you're tricking your husband. Rivka said, anyway, everything will fall in the hands of Esav and his children. The question is, how will they get it? She was a prophet. The prophecy shows the Jews will control the world only when they are fully righteous and satisfying Hashem with their actions. When Esav came, Yitzchak gave him a blessing. V'haya k'asher tarid, ufarak ta'ulo me'al tzavarcha tichye. Once the Jewish nation comes down in a spiritual level, and porkim ol, they release the leash of Hashem from them, like just like a dog that his master is putting him on a leash, and the dog has to go where the master wants him to go. What happens if the dog grip the leash? That's it, it's free. He has no more master. That's the same story with the Jewish people. When they're all fully righteous and religious, nobody can touch them. As soon as they betrayed Hashem, pogrom, holocaust, destruction of first temple, destruction of second temple, antisemitism, exiles, Spain, Portugal, Arabs, fights, intifadas, fear, no peace, no rest. Everything they gain, they go in, come and steal it. And make very high taxes. Pay attention. Check in America. Check the 7 most expensive neighborhoods for taxes, for real estate taxes in America, all Jewish neighborhoods. All Jewish neighborhoods. Jews pay the highest real estate tax on their homes. You want to know where? Beverly Hills, very high taxes. Monsey, very high taxes. Great Neck, very high taxes. Deal, New Jersey, very high taxes. Everywhere around is half. Same thing, Monsey, around half. Great Neck, around half. Where the Jews are, higher taxes. Why? Hashem does it. Don't complain about the authority, don't complain about the... It's all from Hashem. Where do we learn it from? From this parasha. The Gemara explained, Rivka says in the prophecy, anyway what we gain, the Goyim will steal from us. The question is, I rather it come first to us and then go to them. Then it goes directly to them. Why? There's a big difference. The Gemara said, everything the Goyim steal from the Jews, such as property, taxes, money, all kinds of tax in a time of war, count like charity to the Jewish people. Now it's tzedakah. You give money to the yeshiva. You give money to Oakland County or to Nassau County. It's count for you like tzedakah. Why? They robbed me. I have no say. Don't worry. Because of that, the Gemara say it count like tzedakah. That's what Rivka say. Rivka say, Yitzchak wants to give it directly to Esav. I know we can, it's inevitable. Esav will have it. But Esav, I rather Esav has it when the Jewish people do not go according to Hashem's plan, that the Goyim has permission to come and take everything away. At least we get something out of it. It can save us from death, it can save us from, because it counts like charity. When they take your money, it counts like they executed you. Ani chashuv kamet. We have to ask a question. It's written on the Ari HaKadosh 500 years ago that he looked at the forehead of every Jew and he knew everything about him. His reincarnations, what kind of a person he is. You don't have to go that far. The Steigler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, had Ruach HaKodesh. People were shaking when they walked into his room. Even people who did not put black hats during the week, When they came to see the stipler, everybody put their black hat down to cover the forehead. Because he saw on your face exactly who you are. He's not a fool, you can't fool him with your nice beard. He already know. One person told me that he went with one of his assistants. This story was told to me 25 years ago. He said, you're not gonna believe what happened. I went to the stipler with another student of mine. When we walked in, as soon as the stipler saw him, he started to scream, froze my blood, get him out of here, out, out. Like this. And I asked him, what happened for the rap? He started to say, why did I ask this girl? Not modest things. He never dreamed that that's what's the case. Later he came, he said, what happened? Why he got so angry at you? He said that you're doing things that are not modest. And he confessed. In a moment of, he got broken, he got shocked. The stipler, they gave him a list of 37 soldiers fighting in Rahava Sinit. There's a place in Egypt called the Chinese Farm. I guess it's a big farm there. The Israelis, the soldiers were ambushed by Egyptian soldiers, and they maybe moments before they're all gonna be butchered to death. They came quickly to the stipler with a list of all the soldiers, and they asked him to bless all of them. And he started to bless the first, and so he came to the seventh one, he crossed his name with a pen. He read a few more, crossed the name. Read a few more, few of them he already crossed their names. They told him, well, what happened, Rabbi, why are you making lines on them? They already passed. He was sitting in Bnei Brak and they were fighting in Egypt. He already saw what's happening. He had Ruach HaKodesh, like a prophet. So I want to ask you, if the stipler 30, 40 years ago was like this, and the Ari HaKadosh 500 years ago was like this, that they can smell a wicked person right away by looking at him, Yitzchak Avinu is 1,000 times higher in his level from them. He did not know who Esav is, living in his house for so many years. Come on. Every one of us know every one of our children, who is real Ben Torah and who is a faker, who loves Torah and who loves sport, who loves Torah and who loves food. Which girl is modest, which girl we're gonna have problem with when she grow up. You can see it right away, not a fool.
Maybe he saw the whole truth.
The answer is, Yitzchak knew exactly where Esav is. But let me teach you now a trick about chinuch. I learned it from here. What is it like? I'll tell you a story, you get the point. It's Rabbi Rachmiel Kram, I hosted him in one of my lectures in Brooklyn a year ago, if you remember. An interesting speaker. He told that story. He said the mashgiach of the yeshiva ask one of the boys in yeshiva, where were you yesterday? I didn't see you learning. I was sick, he said. I went to Kupat Cholim. I went to the doctor. What time? The Mashgiach asked. He said, 5 p.m. The Mashgiach said, oh, Bezrat Hashem, you should have refuah shlema. But please, next time, if you don't mind, let me know ahead of time that I should not be worried about you. The Mashgiach left the room and all the boys were hysterically laughing. Why? Every fool knows that the Kupat Cholim is closed by 5. Those are 3, 4. Definitely by 5 they close in Israel. And what do you think? The Mashgiach didn't know that? He was already in his 90s. He doesn't know Kupat Cholim. He's been there a few times in his life. And the truth is, Rav Kram said, the Mashgiach knew very well the Kupat Cholim was closed yesterday at 5. But the Mashgiach said, it's very good that he lies to me. It's very good that this boy lied to me. Why? Because if he would tell me, I'm not in the mood to learn, leave me alone. When I come, I learn. When I want to learn, I learn. When I don't want to learn, I don't want to learn. Don't pressure me. I went to play, I went to a movie. Imagine he would answer something like this. As long as he lied to the Mashgiach, that means he has fear and shame from him. When he does something wrong, he's embarrassed or he lies. That means he's 50% connected yet. Still connected. When the moment he comes and takes off his yarmulke and tzitzit and walks around with his earring and walks to the, with his girlfriend on the street and goes to the theater and listens in front of you to all this dirty music that he's listening when he hides, then you know you lost him for good. Now you only need a miracle. So as long as the Mashgiach say later, as long as he tried to find excuses, that means at least in my eye, he's trying to look good. There is still hope, even though we all know what he does behind the scene, but he has a red line that he does not cross in public. So what do we see? That means that he still cares not to show on the outside how he really is. And that's what Esav was. He comes to Yitzchak, Abba, how do you make maaser from the salt? Salt comes from the water. You don't need maaser. It doesn't grow on the ground. You don't need maaser in salt. It's a shela of Amaretz. Doesn't matter. Amaretz that tried to be tzaddik. Right? Amaretz. Sometimes people ask questions, I don't know if it's a joke or serious. I get it every day. I read it a few times to understand maybe I'm missing something here. A simple question. Are you allowed to do on Shabbat such and such? Are you really serious? You're asking such a question. But you see how they care about little things. Okay, very good. So Yitzchak goes along with his tricks. He pretends he's a tzaddik, good, his wife. He wants to keep him close. If I push him out, throw him out, say, yalla, get out of here. Avram threw Ishmael out to see what happened in the end. Ishmael went, married all these people in the desert. He said, I keep him around here. I watch him. As long as he's next to me, he's gonna stay at least one leg into the religion. Maybe one day we'll have awakening. So, it says to him, oh, great Esav, great question. Don't worry, son, you don't have to do maaser on the soul, but I appreciate you asking, Baruch Hashem, it's very good that you care. That's how he talks to him. Why? This is the kind of kid you have. You have to talk to him like this. Now, who Yitzchak shows more love to Esav? Rivka, it's hard for him. She can show love to Esav, she show love to Yaakov. Why? Think about it. What's the difference between Yitzchak and Rivka? Oh, the question is where they grew up. Yitzchak grew up in the house of the biggest tzaddik in the world, Avraham Avinu. Love Torah, love Hashem, hospitality, holiness, emunah. So, it's nothing special for him. I grew up like this. I grew up in such an environment. So, yeah, my son, Baruch Hashem, is like this. My father was also like this. It's nothing out of the ordinary. She grew up in a house of wicked idol worshippers. She never saw someone sit and learn Torah, leave the world, all what the world has to offer, sits in a tent all day and learn Torah. For her, it's incredible. It's a miracle. She cannot understand. How can it be that I got so lucky to have such a son when I come from such a horrible family? Everyone appreciates what's strange for him. Meaning, I didn't grow up like this. That's why I'm so excited. We never had this. If you take a rich kid who grew up in a mansion, when you see other rich people, is there anything special for him? Who are they compared to us? Take a poor person, bring him to a house of rich people, walks around, touch everything, check, ask questions. Why? Special for him.
Didn't
Yitzchak grow up with Ishmael, but Avraham kicked Ishmael also. When he was after 13, Ba'asara came and kicked him out. She kicked him out. So Rabbi Eliezer said, in the time of Beit HaMikdash, a person come, give donation or sacrifice and repent. If there's no Beit HaMikdash, comes the Goyim, grab what the Jews own by force, and נחשב להם צדקה. Where is the source? Isaiah 60, ישעיה סמך, ונוגסייך צדקה. נוגס, someone bites from what you have. Bites, take off, steal. It will come to you צדקה. The goyim come and bite from what we have, don't eat your heart. In שמיים it comes like you give צדקה. כאשר היהודים משלמים ארנונה ומיסים לגויים, when the Jews pay taxes, real estate tax, school tax, police tax, fire tax, library. In one sea is the worst feeling. Why? In other places, most Jews, they send their children to public school, unfortunately. So they pay school tax, the money goes to the public school that serves their own children. And in one thing, nobody sends his kids to public school. There's thousands of kids, not one of them go to public school. So we pay for the public school, which none of us use. And it's very high tax every year. 15,000, 16,000 go just for the school. And we never use it. We never use it. Also the library. How many Hasidim goes to the library to read about Shakespeare? Who cares about it? You know how much they take? Close to $1,000 a year for this library. Every family pays $1,000 and nobody ever goes into that. Well, the mother goes. But other people, they pay so much for the library. Now the poor people that use the library a lot, they don't pay so much for the library because they live in very small, simple houses out of Monsi, which the taxes there is a third or a quarter. So they pay 100, 200 to the library and they use all the books. The one that never used the books pay all the bills. That's taxes. That's why it counts like tzedakah, don't worry. I will count it for you like you give charity.
Isn't
not
all tzedakah equal?
Huh? Not all tzedakah
is equal.
Of course not all tzedakah is equal. You compare giving to Finkelstein library than to give to a kosher yeshiva? Come on. But better than nothing, no? The Gemara says if a Jew lost his wallet, let's say there's $200 there, and after he lost it, he said, I hope that one Talmid yeshiva will find it and use the money for good thing. Right? For Shabbat, for food, for his children. And a real Jew found it and used it, the money. And it counted for him as a tzedakah. Why? He never wanted to give tzedakah. It was forced on him. So we see that by tzedakah, there is an aspect of what in the end came out of your money. You had intention, you didn't have intention. Very important. When you give with intention, your reward is a lot greater. But in the end, if your money was used to something positive, you got something out of it. So if you lost money, pray. They said that Rav Zusha had two gloves. He was sitting on the train. And he took one, his hand out of the train, and one of the gloves fell. I read it about Rav Zusha. So the glove fell. So right away he took the other glove, and he threw it outside. So his assistant asked him, what did he do? You already lost one glove, why are you throwing the other one? Say, look, what will I do with one glove? I'm not going to walk in the street with one glove. So since one already fell on a train track, that means the second one became also worthless. So the person that will find it at least will have two gloves. That's called rachav ayin. Some people, tzare ayin. They rather the gloves will be burned and no one will enjoy from it. This is the person saying, if Hashem decreed on me the damage, at least let's benefit someone from it. Okay, very good thinking. Time is running out. So, when you the Torah and the mitzvot from your neck, right? You will also get rid of the control, when the Jews will get rid of the weight of the Torah and the mitzvot from their neck, you will also get rid of their control over you. That's it. So the interest of the Goyim, that the Jews will be wicked. The more wicked the Jews will be, the better it is for them. Why? Because everything the Jews have, they take. Right? That's what's going on here. The Torah said. I once had a person with his wife. I wanted to invite him. He used to come to my lectures. I used to give to Israelis in a real estate. I used to give them lectures like 24 years ago. And this guy started to become closer and closer with his wife. And I wanted to invite them for Shabbat. They didn't have kids yet. They were married, maybe here, not even. But he had very long ponytail. And we lived in a neighborhood of extreme Hasidei Kloisenburg. All the kids shaved head, long perot. I already know if this guy would show up in my neighborhood with his ponytail, all the Yiddish kids would run, shake it, go, he would scream at him, what are you doing here? Especially if he comes with a kippah, they will be very confused. So I asked him, how about you take a haircut before you come, get rid of this foolish ponytail? So he said to me, oh, it took me years to grow the hair. It took me years. I said, okay, but what do you need it? Don't worry, you look good without it. You're already married. What do you need it for? No, no, I like it. But don't worry. I'm going to come with a hat, and I will push it under the hat, and no one will see it. I said, well, the whole Shabbat you'll be with the hat? Yes. So, okay. He came with a hat, you know, like the limousine driver. So I was holding my hat. When I saw it, the entire Shabbat, we have other guests, beautiful atmosphere. Motzei Shabbat came, they're getting ready to leave, back to Queens. So I say to him, you don't expect me to let you leave my house with this ponytail. I gotta give you a haircut, come. He said, no, I don't touch the hair, it took me here. No matter what I say to him, it's bad luck for a man to have long hair, it brings judgment and to his life. No. So I have nothing to lose. He's already one step out of the house. I told him, let's ask Hashem what he thinks. So what do you mean? So we open the Chumash, we'll see what's going to happen. He said to me, Ma, you can do such a thing? I said, yeah, we'll make a special prayer. Hashem, if we have the schut, Hashem will give us an answer. But what comes out on the right side, you must do. His wife, yeah, let's see. They get curious. I said, dear God, show me if you want me to get rid of this ponytail. Show me. I said, open! Open the Chumash, first row on the right. Ve'aleha ka'asher tarid, ופרקת הוא לא מעל צווחה. This pasuk, when you remove it from the back of your neck, צוואר, right after that he said, תחיה, you should live. I said to him, I don't think in all Tanakh you have a pasuk that speak about something in the back of the neck like your stupid ponytail. He was shocked. I said, come. He said, no, don't worry, I promise you, tomorrow I go to the barber, I cut it. So remember, give me your hand. Yes. The next day he called me up, don't worry, you can relax. I got rid of the ponytail. So he got rid of the ponytail, chazru betshuva, became shomrei Shabbat, became religious. 2 or 3 weeks ago, if you remember, there was a girl who came to speak to me after the lecture, 20 years old, 19 years old. I speak to her, Bezrat Hashem, soon I'm getting married, I came for you to give me bracha, to ask a few questions. Where are you from? My name is such and such. So, oh, very interesting. You know my parents. Who is her parents? Life, choices that you make in life have long-term consequences. Such sweet girl, She listens to the lecture, she became בעלת תשובה. She's getting married to a בחור that listens to me 24/6. She told me my future husband got me to listen to your lecture. It made me very strong, we're getting married, we're gonna keep everything. And when she told me she's the daughter of this couple, I had a flashback how that Motzei Shabbos, we opened the Chumash. Hashem already saw that moment. You understand? So this is it, Rabotai. You make the right choices, you won't regret. Now I want to ask you a question. Are you allowed to trick a person to steal a mitzvah from him? Somebody knocks on the door, you and your friend sitting in the living room, and you see from the glass of the door that there's some Hasidish man standing by the door. You already know, is they collecting for yeshiva or something. They come usually in the evening. So now there's a mitzvah to run gift tzedakah. So the person, your friend wants to go to the door, he's gonna get the mitzvah. You tell him, no, no. Go see over there something, right? You run quickly and you do the mitzvah. This is not such a good example because both of you here can give tzedakah. But what happened when one of you can only do the mitzvah? It's either you or him. Can you trick him and steal the mitzvah from him or no? If he was on the way to do it and you call him, Moshe, Moshe, come one second. I'm going to... Wait, wait, come here. When you come, wait here one second. You want, you do the mitzvah and you come back. Hey, it's not fair. I was about to do it. The question is it allowed or no?
Yes. No. So I can't
go. Let's see. Let's see. We learn everything from the Torah. The Sha'arei Tshuva, Siman Taf Pei Bet. He writes, Yesod Gadol, big foundation. Although you're not allowed to cheat your friend, meaning to fool your friend, to take what's his. You're not allowed to deceive him. This is things that has financial values. Things that either it's cash or world cash. You're not allowed to trick him, to take from him, to make him a damage, to fool him when it comes to money. But with mitzvot, you are allowed. Kol HaKodem Zoche, first serve. For instance, somebody slaughtered a chicken now, Shochet. There is sand right there. Two people standing and watching how the poor chicken is struggling for his life. Your friend is saying, where is the shovel? What does he want? He wants to get some sand and cover their blood. It's mitzvah to cover the blood. You're not so spoiled. You take it with your hands, you make the bracha, and you cover the sand. By the time he went to the garage to bring the shovel, he came back, what? Where is the blood? I covered it already. Hey, it's not fair, I stole it from me. I told you I'm going to bring the shovel. Until you bring the shovel, the Mashiach came twice already. I have a mitzvah in front of me. You want me to wait for you? Did you do something wrong? No. But what happened if your friend prepared a bucket of sand? And he also owned the chicken, and he slaughtered the chicken, and he's about to take the sand and cover, and he stole it from his hand and did it. Now he already had position on the mitzvah, and you actually stole it from him while he was doing it, second before. And he takes you to Bet Din, to Din Torah. You have to pay him 10 zeubim, 10 coins of gold, it's a lot of money. For the mitzvah. You have to pay him for stealing the mitzvah from him. So a mitzvah that is the hefker, everyone can come and do, it's not your mitzvah. You see a blind person waiting in the intersection for someone to help him to cross the street. That's chesed d'oraita. You and your friends walking and you both saw him. Your friends say, oh, I'm gonna go help the poor man to cross the street, and you gave a big sprint and you grabbed his hand. Let me help you, grandpa. What did you do? I told you that I'm going to... I'm sorry. Until you move, I wanted the mitzvah for myself. Of course, it doesn't look good. I'll give you an example. If it would be a diamond ring on the floor, 10 carat, and your friend said, oh, I think there's a big diamond ring over there, your drum jumped with your suit on the mat, Don't push, it was mine, boom, punches. Your best friend, then Cara Diamond. Don't ever talk to me, don't come to me, I don't want to hear from you, okay? It's worth it to get rid of you for $1 million. But when it comes to the mitzvot, yeah, no, why me? No, you saw it first, you go. People are very generous, why? Because they don't evaluate the value of the mitzvot. They don't evaluate. If they evaluate the real value of a mitzvot, the endless reward, they would grab each other's hair. It's written in the time of Bet HaMikdash, the Kohanim, when they go on a rap, they push each other, sometimes a person would fall and die. Because they were pushing each other to do the mitzvah first.
It's not like the other person loses. But he wanted to do the mitzvah, so he gets a reward too.
That's a good point. A person that wants to do mitzvah, it's written, Ma'ale ani alav ki'ilu asa. Ki'ilu. I give him a reward like he actually did it. The question is it really full reward like he actually did it? Maybe yes. But reality, who did it? Someone else did it. Okay. So it has to be some difference than someone who actually physically did it. Oh. So
that goes back to it's going on young.
But you know what? You ask, how do you learn that you're allowed to fool a person with words, deceive him, in order for you to get the mitzvah in on him? How do you know?
Yeah.
I'll give you an example. Let's say a rabbi calls you up and you're a rich man. We want to build a mikveh in our yeshiva. We need $50,000. I want you to speak to your rich friend. You have a friend that is 10 times wealthier than you. I want you to speak to your rich friends. He once told me that he wants to build a mikveh for the memory of his mother. So now we're ready. Ask him if he can come tomorrow to the yeshiva and talk to the rabbi for the design of the mikveh. And you went, you didn't tell your friend, you went, how much you need, you say, 50? Here is the 50. I want to get the mitzvah. You did something wrong or no? Based on that, no. Not only that, if your friend will ask you, what did the rabbi want from you? Did he ask about me something about the mikveh? No, he was talking about something else. Then you run quickly and do it. And rabbi signed here that the mikveh is my mitzvah. The question is, I know it doesn't look good, but in the positive thing is you show Hashem how anxious you are to steal every possible mitzvah. But we need a source. You have to agree that for something so fragile, you need a source. Where is the source? Let me give it to you. The source is that we had the story in Megillat Rut. Boaz was the head of the Sanhedrin. And he said, "Beyon kenotcha sade miyad Naomi umeet Rut haMoavia." We have Rut and Orpah. They are the daughter-in-law of Naomi. Naomi is married to Elimelech. He was a tzaddik, talmid chacham, but he left Israel. He decided to come to Las Vegas to sell cosmetic in the mall, meaning. There's no parnasa in Israel. He went overseas to do some business. His sons, Mahlon and Kilion, already married to Goyot, Ruth and Orpah. That's what happened. You come to America, your children are not getting the proper education. Don't be surprised. So they married the Goyot. Hashem killed both of them. So now is Naomi and Ruth and Orpah, and they're going now to Israel, and she said to them, go back to your country. Well, no, Ruth said, I'm with you. Orpah went back. That night she did some acts of prostitutions, and she conceived, and her son was Goliath. Was born Goliath Aplishti. Ruth stuck to Naomi, best friends, mother-in-law and daughter-in-law. Now they came, at that time you have Boaz the Tzaddik, he's the head of the Sanhedrin. So now, Boaz said there is Goel, Goel, a relative of the family that has the right to marry her before anyone else. So Boaz wants her for himself. So he's going to trick him. He's the biggest chacham in the world. He's coming to deceive a person that he should steal the mitzvah from him. Why? Because he's seen Ruach HaKodesh that from this woman the Mashiach would come. David HaMelech came from Ruth. And the Messiah came from David. Who doesn't want the Mashiach to come from his children? What am I going to give him now? So what he came to him? He said, "Beyom knotcha sadeh miyad Naomi." When you go and buy the field from Naomi and from Ruth HaMoaviah, he highlight Ruth the Goya, Moaviah, meaning it looks bad. Like he said, Ruth the Palestinian. By the way, he got scared. Why the chief rabbi telling me this Ruth the Goya? Ooh, look how he gets angry when he said the Goya. Gets him nervous. לפי שצפה ברוח הקודש, שעתיד לצאת מחלציה שלשלת מלכות בית דוד, he saw in his holy vision that from here, the kingdom of David will come. That's why he say המואביה, כדי שימענו ויקחה הוא. He wanted to scare him that he said, I'm giving up my right. Right away, jump and marry her. Boaz said to the Goel, Ruth, she's Moaviah, and made him scared to marry her. Why? Because there is a pasuk in the Torah. Lo yavo amoni u'moavi bekal Hashem. Hashem say, Moavi and Amoni, those two nations, they can never convert. Why? Because they are ungrateful. They did not give you bread and water when you passed through their land, when you came out of Egypt. Even though your grandfather Abraham saved their grandfather Lot and they did not appreciate it, people that have no gratitude, I do not want them in my nation, because Judaism is all about gratitude. So they are not welcome. When he heard Moaviah, he got very scared. Ooh, Hashem hates the Moavim. I'm going to marry Moaviah. Soon as he gave up, Boaz went. Imagine what he thought. Oh, man, you tricked me. You told me yesterday she's Moaviah. I understood that it's not good. Oh, you want to marry her? Yes, I wanted the mitzvah for myself. I want David HaMelech to be my grandson, not your grandson. I want Mashiach to come from me. So from here we learn that it's allowed. Mamshich HaShare Tshuva, continue to write. And this is the same story with Yaakov Avinu. Yaakov saw that Esav is wicked. If he's going to get the Bechora, right? What is he going to do? It's going to create problems. Better the Bechora would come to someone who sits and learns Torah. Now I want to tell you something. Everybody knew that Yaakov is meant for Rachel and Esav is meant for Leah. Right? No. Esav for Leah, Yaakov for Rachel. Leah was crying non-stop that she doesn't want to fall in the hands of this Rasha. Right? That's what it's written in the Torah, Ve'enei Leah Rakot. Ve'enei Leah Rakot, meaning her eyelashes fell off from crying so much until Hashem said, no more. He also said, it's a week. So, in the end, if I had time, I don't have time, maybe tomorrow I will finish it. You see how everything falls into place. So, now we have Vayetarnu Hashem. HaKadosh Baruch Hu heard the prayers of Yitzchak and not the prayers of Rivka. We have a question to ask. Rivka, she prayed for her condition. She is now barren. It's a sickness. She cannot have children. We learn that if a sick person pray for himself and somebody else pray for him, his prayers can help himself more than strangers, more than even his mother. We learned it from Ishmael. Hagar was praying for Ishmael. Ishmael was praying for himself not to die, and the Torah says, "Vayishma Hashem lekol hanar." So Chazal say that the prayer of a sick person on himself is more able to save your life than someone else praying for you. Why? Someone else, as much as he loves you, as much as he loves you and cares about you, he doesn't have the broken heart that you have when you're sick fighting for your life. And the broken heart of a sick person is a huge advantage. As it's written, Lev nishbar venitke, Elokim lo tifzeh. A broken heart works. With tears, it's a magic, it's a wonder. So over here, it's a little bit strange. Rivka crying to have children, she doesn't want to be barren. Yitzchak is praying for her, and Hashem accepts the prayers of Yitzchak. Why? Why not the prayers of Rivka? The Gemara says, Vayetar lo, Rashi writes, lo velo la, to him and not to her. Why? A son of a righteous, that his father or mother is wicked, is not as a prayer of a righteous son of righteous. Yitzchak is righteous and his father is righteous. She is righteous, but her father is wicked. Righteous son of righteous is greater than righteous son of wicked. And right away we have the question to ask, didn't the Gemara say, במקום שבעלי תשובה עומדים אפילו צדיקים גמורים אינם עומדים? In a place that the Baal Tshuva reach, even righteous from birth cannot reach. Someone who was in the mud, in the garbage, and was able to come out of there and give up all the desire and become righteous after he was full of sins is much greater than someone who was all his life righteous. That's true. No question about that. Here we're not talking about just the righteousness of Yitzchak or Rivka. We're talking about where they grew up. Where they grew up. What does it mean where they grew up? When you grow up in a house that your father is a very big rabbi, genius, Talmid Chacham, all the eyes of all the people in the world are aimed to you. Will you reach the level of your great father or not? It builds mountain of pressure on the children. That's why I've seen an advice that if you are a figure, a famous person, and very charismatic and influential, such as big rabbi or prime minister or famous person or very rich father in business, very good and recommended to send your sons away from home for a period of time to learn and stay in a dorm far away, that they can develop their own personality on their own and not be under your shadow. Why? Because the pressure may break them. And they say, the mission is impossible, I can't reach. Can't reach the level of my father. No matter how much I'm going to learn, I don't reach 10% of him. I might as well just give up. Anyway, I'm a loser. That's how it is. And we see a lot of children, they're not reaching the level of their father. The Gemara have an expression for it. The Gemara call it Chometz Ben Yain. Vinegar, son of wine. Son of wine. Wine can be very expensive. The older it is, the more superb it is, it's not mevushal. It can be $1,000 a bottle. It reminds me that yesterday I said, let me drink a little bit dry wine, a little bit, a sip. I opened the wines, you know, people come for Shabbat, they bring wines. Usually a bottle of wine is how much? $15, $20. Usually you go to the kosher store, most of them is mevushal. Nothing fancy. This bottle, I don't know about wine, it's thousands of names. I see a bottle, I look at it, see, not mevushal. Oh, I'm alone here, no one is here, I can open it. I pour myself, as soon as I drink from it, and I'm nothing, no expert in wine. Some people, they taste the wine, they'll tell you right away what kind of grapes. I've seen a guy was in Herzliya Pituach for Shabbat. In the table there was a guy, Baal Tshuva, that was some kind of diplomat in Germany. he spoke in the United Nations, somebody in a really big shot. So I come to the table, he came. Why he came? Because he likes my nature. So he came, he's a single guy, he sits over there and we talk. You know how you meet people on Shabbat? What's his job? Until he became a Baal Tshuva, he was a world expert for tasting wine. Every wine he tastes, he will tell you from where it came and what year, and unbelievable. Now he can't do it anymore. Because all these young wines in the show, it's non-kosher. So he gave up the job. Baruch Hashem became tzaddik. But he brought like 5 or 6 bottles of wine. And he gave us a speech on each bottle. The grapes came from Georgia. A place in Georgia that has the best grapes in the world. You do it like this, you put it in a barrel like this. Oak, that one. It's an old encyclopedia. You have to be an expert in wines, it's not so simple. Me, I'm a totally ignorant in wine. What do I know? So I see about it, I pour myself, I drink. But even someone like me, this wine tastes something special in it. I say, let me check the name. I googled about it. But I wanted to pull my hair off. It's an expensive bottle. How much it cost? $160. So, wow! Yes. You better give it to someone who appreciates wine. For me, it's the same thing like drinking a $10, $15. You give it a gift to someone who knows about wine. Wow, you look at the bottle, what a great bottle. Special. I said I just burned with my hands $160. Why? Because I don't know wines. That's stupidity. Next time you check before you open. Why do you know? By looking at the bottle, you don't know necessarily if it's expensive or not. So over here, we have now the prayer of Tzaddik ben Tzaddik and Tzaddik ben Rasha. And Hashem listened to his prayer. But we have to ask a question from the Gemara. The Gemara says, Masechet Ketubot, page 67. The Gemara said there was a big rabbi, his name was Mar Ukba. Him and his wife used to give things to the poor people. And they would knock on the door, throw the money inside and run. They don't want him to know that the money comes from them. Not like today. A person takes money from his friend and he comes pretend he gave the money. Back in time, people gave the money and say someone else gave the money. Right? They don't want honor for the mitzvah. So, one time the poor person was dying out of curiosity. You know, people are curious. He waited for them all day. Soon as he heard the knocking, boom! He opened the door, but they already were running, and he chased them now. He only sees their back, he doesn't see who it is. They run in the streets over there, and they saw a place, he grabbed them inside. They walked inside, they didn't realize, they actually walked into a big oven room. Once they were bringing bread over there, they put it over there, and in the whole room it's oven. Underneath is fire, under the ground. It's wood ground, and it's fire underneath. So their legs are burning. So they're jumping now. The poor man is looking for them outside. They can't go out. So she said to him, put your legs on mine, if you're burning. So he got his legs on hers, and she was not screaming. She was able to take the heat. So he said, how can it be that she suffered the heat less than me? That means she's more righteous than me. I learned Torah all day in Yeshiva, and she's in the house cooking food, and she's already greater than me. What's her secret? So his wife told him, I'll tell you what's the difference. You give cash to the poor. I give them ready food to eat. They take your cash, they have to go to the market to buy food, to cut it, to clean it, to cook it. 2 or 3 hours until they have a meal. I already give them the food ready. When they come, you hungry? here is chicken, here is rice. They don't have to do anything. They eat right away, they're ready. So, because my mitzvah is more perfect than you, you only give cash. What did I never do with the cash? I have to go shopping, there's a lot of work. That's why my chesed is higher than yours. So, that's one example of how the merit of a woman is higher than a man. The Gemara in Masechet Ta'anit, page 23, the Gemara said that there was no rain in the time of Abba Chilkiah. Abba Chilkiah was a grandson of Choni HaMa'agel. Remember a few times I told the story about him, that he came home and his wife was coming out, dressed up with makeup to him, and the rabbi asked him, why your wife coming out like this, so dressed for you? And he said, because she doesn't want me to look at other women. Remember this? This is the same one, Tzadik. This family, when they pray for rain, the rain begins. His grandfather, Choni HaMa'agel, Abba Chilkiah, they have this. So, they ask him all the time, pray for rain, pray for rain. Him and his wife, when the people from the bedding came to ask him for rain, him and his wife went up to the attic and they prayed. And the rain came from her side, not from his side, the clouds. He was praying on one side and she was praying on the other side. And the clouds started to come from her side. The rabbis asked him, why the clouds came from your wife's and not from you? You are the one who brings the rain. So he says, because when a poor person comes, she gives them right away the bread ready. When they come to me, I only give them money and have to go and find a bread or bake a bread. She benefits the poor better than me. Meaning we learn from this Gemara. The Gemara wants to teach one concept here. When you do charity, do it in the best possible way. That a person will not have to go and work very hard to get it. Right? So based on that, who is the bigger Baal Chesed? Rivka or Yitzchak? Rivka. So Hashem should have listened to our prayers, not to him. Some people, they think that there's no problem of going to all kinds of babot. You know what a baba is?
Kabbalist.
I wish they were Kabbalists. They pretend that they are Kabbalists. Fake babot. Do this, do that, wait, let me see what I see. Oh yeah, all done. Take mint leaves, put under your yarmulke when you sleep. Get up in the morning, go over there, take water, and make up all kinds of things. A person goes home, I went to this big tzaddik, you have to see his eyes, wow, his beard, looks like an angel. So, there was one like this, in a grave of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. 20 years he sits there, beard, turban, white kid. People by mistake thought maybe it's Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Came out of his grave. For 20 years, people come to him, he has a big basket, put 100, 200 shekel. Mishaberach, Avotenu Avraham Yitzchak Yaakov, Mivarechet, Rivka, Bat Betuel. He gives brachot to people. And to the man, he said, did you put tefillin today? Make sure you put every day tefillin, and Shabbat you have to keep. And my bracha will give you a big miracle, Bezrat Hashem, in 9 months you will have twins. Yes? Yeah, but 20 years we don't have kids, don't worry. My word. 9 months you have twins, but one condition. You must put tefillin and you keep Shabbat. Very good. Looks like a very good rabbi. He gives some musar. After 20 years, they found out he's an Arab. Not a Jew. He's an Arab. I don't have to tell you the shock that people got. But one person came to him and said to him, I don't understand. You were telling people put tefillin, keep Shabbat, much like a rabbi. So he said to them, what do you expect me to say, you fool? Go to the mosque? They think I'm a Kabbalist. I have to tell them, keep Shabbat, put tefillin. I wonder how many people started to keep Shabbat thanks to this faker. That's a good question. Will he get a reward for it? Let's see 15 people became Shomrei Shabbat. thanks to this Abba. Will he get the rewards for it or not?
Yeah.
No. I tell you what, Og was hoping that Abraham go to save Lot and will die, that Og should take Sarah. So Og meant for good or for bad? For bad. He wanted Abraham to get killed. But Abraham saved Lot, and there was a good thing next to it. He was the messenger. And it's written that Abraham was afraid that Noah and Tzadikim, they were afraid of the merit of Og. They came to the place, they say, Og lives there, he has a zchut. Why is he was the one who sent Abraham to save Lot? Yesh lo zchut, he has merit. What merit? He wanted Abraham to die. So from here you see that even if you means bad, but some big mitzvah came out of you, some kind of merit you get. Needless to say, when you have good intention and you do it for the sake of heaven, there's nothing to talk about. So, mamash, the last thing, and we'll finish here. Rivka was barren for 20 years. Some people say, I'm gonna go to this Baba. How do I know if he's real or not? I have no idea. How should I know? How should I know? He looks holy. Do I know if he's real or not? Maybe he's not even Shomer Shabbat. What do I have to lose besides some money? If he's real, I get $500. Maybe something big will happen. If not, kaparat avonot. I lost $500. Especially if he's rich, doesn't care. That's a very big mistake. A common and very big mistake. Blessings from this kind of people can make a huge damage to you. How come? We learned it from Rivka. Rivka was damaged because she got a blessing from her father and her brother, Betuel and Lavan. They told her, you should multiply to be tens of thousands of children. Tens of thousands of children. Biglal Shelavan and Betuel gave her a blessing, two idol worshippers. Hashem on purpose made her barren for 20 years. Why? That no one in the world would say, thanks to their idols, she got a child or many kids. So Hashem actually made her worse for her. Same thing when you go to a fake Baba. And Hashem hates him so much for tricking and deceiving people. So, if you will get what he blessed you for, people will give credit to who? To someone Hashem cannot stand. So not only you're not gonna get what Hashem wanted to give you, because you went to that faker, what was coming for you, you lost. You got it. So what's the solution? Don't go to anyone you don't know 100%. Don't go. Count on Hashem. Why do you need middlemen? Why do you need middlemen? I don't understand. Hashem is everywhere. You can talk to him no matter where you are. Anyway, if you go to a middleman, he's begging Hashem to help you. Beg Hashem yourself. Especially if your heart is broken, it's going to be even better with tears. With tears. Especially if you give a lot of tzedakah. I told over the years to a bunch of couples that couldn't have kids. I said to them, simple common sense. Everything Hashem does is midah keneged midah, measure for measure. For good and for bad. You hurt someone in one way, someone will hurt you in the same way, one day. You help someone in one way, someone will help you in one way. The Gemara say there was a person called Nehemia Chofer Shichin. Nehunya Chofer Shichin. He used to dig holes in the ground, deep holes, the water comes out, you know, water from the ground, fill it up with water for the people who come to Jerusalem that they will have water. They need to wash themselves, they need their animals to drink. Water in the ground. So he used to walk voluntarily to make a lot of wells in Jerusalem that the people that come will have water, because if you won't do it, nobody wants to come to Beit HaMikdash in the holidays, in the festival. So voluntarily, he goes and dig and he cover it, and when they come, they have water ready. It wasn't like today, a faucet, you press a button, those are different words. One time he was learning in yeshiva, somebody ran quickly to him, Rabbi, Rabbi, your daughter fell into a pit. She's very deep in the ground. So he said to him, relax, relax, soon she's gonna come up. No, she's deep in the ground, we have to somehow save her, we have to go down. An hour later, he asked him, did she get up already? No, not yet. Continue to learn. And I'm like, no, did she get up then? No. Then, no, did she get up yet? She got up. How are you not nervous? Your daughter is maybe is dying down there. Maybe the snakes, who knows? Why are you not nervous? So I say to them, any other way I would be very nervous. But when you told me that she fall into a deep hole in the ground, a pit, I know that nothing will happen to her. It's impossible. Why? Because it cannot be that in what I do all my life is digging holes for people that they should come to Beit HaMikdash, that in one of these holes that I dug for the sake of Beit HaMikdash, that one of my children will die there. That's the opposite of measure for measure. Hashem does not pay bad for something good you do. If he gives you bad, it's for something bad you did in the same field. So since I gave my life to make those holes for the sake of heaven, there's no way Hashem is going to use what I did good to kill one of my kids there. If you tell me she went on the street and a snake bit her, or a horse hit her, or she fell from a building, yes, I would run quickly to see what I can do. Once you told me she fell in one of these pits, I got very relaxed. They lived the Torah. Lived it. It was mamash so obvious for them. They, oh, maybe, wow, how do we know? Who told you? Who do you think you are? Why are you speaking in the name of Hashem? No, we only say what's written, but nobody has a guna. Almost nobody. So what happened? If somebody goes and count on someone that Hashem cannot stand, Hashem has a problem. I can't give it to you because people would run and give credit to this Rasha, and that's not what I want. So because of that, is that not only you didn't get it, you actually lost what you're supposed to. Why? Everything Hashem does is measure for measure. So when couples come to me that cannot have kids, I told them, let's think. What do you need from Hashem? You want children. So you have to do something that Hashem will pay you measure for measure. So, what's the options? Hashem has many children that are lost. No Shabbat, no tefillin, on the streets, all kinds of drug addicts, all kinds of apikorsim, infidels, horrible. And if you invest your money in Hashem's children to bring them back, to make them Baalei Tshuva, Hashem will say to the Satan that object, he doesn't want you to have kids, keeps objecting. Hashem will say to the Satan, what's your objection? He takes care of my lost children, bring them back to me. They are reborn. I have to give him children. He doesn't have children. Measure for measure. And Baruch Hashem, in almost all cases, it worked. People that could not have kids for years, they tried 4 years, 7 years, 11 years. Boom! All of a sudden, twins. All of a sudden, a child. Why is it? Mida keneged mida. You care about my children, I care about your children. When I told Rav Shmuel Vozner Alevi, one of Gdolei Ador who passed a few years ago, and he said, someone, it's written in a Gemara, Masechet Megillah, page 24, someone who makes his tefillin round, someone makes his tefillin round, instead of square, I want to make it nicer. Let's make it round. What do you mean? The Torah says to be four sides. Shin on one side, shin on the other. No, I want to do it my way. Someone that makes his tefillin round is dangerous for him. Why dangerous? Say he has no mitzvah. He definitely doesn't have mitzvah tefillin, but why dangerous? Why? What's the reason? The Or Zarua, one of Gdolei HaRishonim, he says, when a person used the names of Kodesh, holy names, such as written in the Torah and the Tefillin, not for the sake of mitzvah, for personal use, not for what Hashem said to do, he puts himself in danger. Put himself in danger. It's because round tefillin is no mitzvah, the names of Hashem and all the holy names that he written inside, not only does not help, become poison for you. Very dangerous for your life. In the old days, people wanted to write all kinds of names in the back of the mezuzah. The Rambam writes very much against it, against these ignorant people who wants to add names because they want the mezuzah to keep them. Then would the mezuzah watch the safety of the house? Yes. But when you put mezuzah, oy vey, if you think I put mezuzah to keep my house safe, to save us from fire and tragedies, God forbid. Why do you put mezuzah? Because Hashem said so. That's it. Because Hashem said it. I have to do it because it's mitzvah from the Torah. Because it's mitzvah from the Torah. Bezrat Hashem, it's enough for today. Tomorrow I have a lot more interesting stuff to talk about. We talk about why Yaakov and Esau was fighting inside the womb, and then the story with the whales, the antisemitism, the roots of the first time antisemitism in the world and the consequences of it, Rabbi and Antoninus, and a lot of interesting things coming up tomorrow. Baruch Adonai Olam. Amen. Amen. Rabbi Hanania.